Welcome to this video. Today we're going to be looking into the future to try and predict what the world will look like in 2050 and then make a passive ETF portfolio that will potentially give us the best returns for 2050. So I've done a lot of research for this video and all of that will be in the description, and a lot of this research does come from a report from PwC titled The World in 2050. The first thing we're going to discuss is the demographics between developed and emerging market economies. Today the current world population is 7.6 billion and in 2050 it's expected to be 9.6 billion. The world population of all developed markets has a total population of 1.1 billion. China alone has a population of 1.4 billion and India has a population of 1.3 billion. These population differences are huge and they are one of the main drivers of why emerging markets will grow a lot faster than developed markets. Another huge demographic change is the increase in the middle class. In 2017, there were around 3.6 billion people in the middle and upper class, and it's predicted that in 2030, there will be around 5.6 billion people in the middle class. Essentially, what this means, with more people moving into the middle class, there's going to be more economic development, and a lot of this is going to happen in these emerging markets. It's predicted that 87% of the next billion people moving into the middle class will actually come from Asia, the majority coming from China and India. So these countries have a lot of growth potential to take advantage of. In 2030, it's predicted that China's population will be 70% middle class. All these emerging markets have such a huge population that a lot of them will move into the middle class, and because of this, they will make up the majority of the middle class. Emerging markets have huge room to grow. They have way more people than developed markets, and also they have a lot of room to catch up until they even reach the level of developed markets. And also the technological change that will happen in the world, they have so many factors that will contribute to their huge growth in the future. It is important to consider the barriers to growth in these emerging markets. The education levels, the infrastructure, and the quality of the institutions in these emerging markets will determine if they can reach their long-term growth potential. If they don't increase their education levels and the quality of their institutions, it could really harm their long-term growth potential. These are some of the risks to just consider. Another really interesting point about emerging markets has to do with the Buffett indicator. The Buffett indicator is just an indicator to show whether something is over or undervalued. It can be applied to a single country or a group of countries. The Buffett indicator takes the market cap, or the total valuation of all the stocks in an economy, and divides it by the total GDP in that economy, or how much these companies actually produce. It's taking the total value of all the companies and dividing it by the amount that they produce. A lower figure will show that they're more undervalued, whereas a higher figure will show that they're potentially overvalued. This is because if they have a higher valuation than what they're producing, this is a sign that they're overvalued, whereas if they have a lower valuation than what they're actually producing, this is a sign that they're undervalued. If you were to look at the market cap to GDP ratio, or the Buffett indicator for emerging markets, it is actually 58%, whereas for developed markets, it's 130%. This means that the total valuation of all the companies in emerging markets compared to what they produce is extremely low and potentially undervalued, whereas in developed countries, it could be considered substantially overvalued. This is because the financial and capital markets in these emerging economies are not as developed. They only make up around 30% of the total global financial markets, whereas emerging markets produce around 50% of the world's total GDP. Because of this, their valuation in relation to what they produce is considered a lot lower. Another interesting thing about emerging markets, they are actually underrepresented in global indexes. The most common index that represents the whole global stock market is the MSCI ACWI index. In this index, emerging markets only make up around 12% of the total index, whereas we know that they produce around 50% of the world's GDP and make up around 25% of the whole global stock market. But in these indexes, they are only represented as 12%. And because of this, if you were to buy just one of these indexes, you'd have a much lower exposure to emerging markets than is actually the case in the real world. This is an important point to consider that I'll touch on a bit later when actually constructing your own ETF portfolio. Another important thing to consider is that not all emerging markets are the same. In the past, it was a lot easier to classify them all together. However, today, you can't consider China the same way you would consider Turkey or Argentina, for example. They're two completely different countries with two completely different cultures and infrastructures and economic development. China is moving away from the unsustainable growth model of exports and trying to move into more of a growth model of domestic consumption. In 2010, domestic consumption only made up around 47% of the Chinese GDP, whereas in 2018, it was around 76%. China's already made the transition of having more of their GDP made up by the domestic economy. There's also going to be lots of advances in food, agriculture, smart cities, technology, healthcare, and there are going to be millions of jobs added in these sectors. and it's predicted that almost 90% of these jobs between now and 2030 will be in emerging market economy. So if you really want to take advantage of this huge emerging market growth, it would make sense to include a larger percentage of your portfolio into these emerging markets. But including a larger portion of emerging markets does come with risks. Emerging markets are known to be a lot more volatile, and what this means is just that their price can fluctuate a lot more. Since 1990, there were around 22 occasions where the emerging market index declined by 20% or more, whereas with the S&P 500, this only occurred 4 times. So this is a risk to consider. Emerging markets are a lot more volatile. However, as a long-term investor, you can use this volatility as a source of opportunity. Since it is more volatile, there are going to be more times where the price declines. And because of this, you can take advantage of this. You can buy more often when it crashes. And this just gives you more opportunity to buy at lower prices. JP Morgan predicts that within the next decade, emerging markets will generate around 8% annual returns, whereas developed markets will only generate around 5%. If you do want higher returns in your portfolio, it could make sense to include more emerging markets. Predictions from another firm, AQR, also have a similar trend where emerging markets do have the potential for higher returns. Now that you know all the potential growth and benefits of investing in emerging markets, as well as the potential risks, now you might be asking yourself, well, how do I create an ETF portfolio that can take advantage of this? We know that the MSCI ACII index, which includes developed and emerging market economies, only includes around 12% allocation to emerging markets, whereas they make around 25% of the whole global stock markets. They contribute to around 50% of the total GDP in the world. So we know that this allocation is a lot less than what it actually is in reality. And these emerging markets are predicted to have higher returns. So if you want higher returns in your portfolio, it would make sense to allocate a larger portion to these emerging markets. So what I've done with my ETF portfolio is I have simply just 2 ETFs. I have a Spider MSCI World ETF, which just tracks the developed economies in the world. And then I have another ETF that just tracks emerging market economies. One thing to know is that there are 2 different types of indexes with emerging market economies. There is simply just the MSCI EM index, which represents large and mid-sized companies, and it represents around 85% of the total market cap in these emerging markets. However, the other index is the MSCI EM IMI, which represents large, middle, and small cap companies in these emerging markets, and this represents around almost 99% of the total stock market in these emerging economies. If you do want to include small caps, it would make sense to actually invest in the ETF that tracks the MSCI EM IMI index. I will leave a list of ETFs on the screen that you guys can look at and make your decision. These are the best ones that I've found that have the lowest expense ratio, but also a good amount of assets under management. And these are also accumulating ETFs. But if you want to learn more about that, you can check out my previous video. That's about all I have to say about emerging markets and building an ETF portfolio. It's really simple. You just have one for developed and one for emerging markets, and you can increase the allocation of your emerging market position to as high or as low as you want it to be, depending on your risk levels. That's up to you guys to decide. Remember, I'm not an investment advisor. I'm just trying to give you guys some information on emerging markets and what the potential future could look like in 2050. So I hope you guys have enjoyed. I spent a lot of time researching this video, so it would mean a lot if you could hit that subscribe button. Also smash the like button if you enjoyed. If you don't want to miss out on videos like this, where I do a lot of research and take more of an impartial position, definitely hit that subscribe button. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.